afternoon, everybody. Thanks for joining in. This is Venkatesh. I'm co-founder of growcurve.com. We're a marketplace for sales and marketing solutions. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce to you our speaker for the day, Tarun Jyot Singh. Tarun's an old friend and co-founder of One Digital Stack. He's going to talk to us about how to increase sales on Amazon, something I'm sure we're all looking forward to knowing more about. So Tarun, welcome and over to you.
Hi guys, my co-founder Rohit and I are on the call, and a little bit about me. I've been in sales and marketing for over 9 years now, and I've worked in large FMCG companies. So, we've been in sales and marketing for almost 10 years now, and I've worked in large companies like Unilever and ITC, and also a D2C startup. So this is my second stint, doing a startup, and the genesis of the idea was because when I was doing a D2C startup, I felt that there's a lot of scope and improvement to be done in terms of how digital marketing and e-commerce marketing is done in India, and that's the genesis of the idea of what we're doing right now. I will just share my screen and share, my thoughts on how Amazon works and how, we can utilize the platform better for high revenue or optimization of sales, whatever your goal is. So, we'll start with role of Amazon in digital marketing funnel, a little bit about, what digital marketing funnel is. And then we start on to what are the fundamentals of sales on Amazon. Essentially, how we look at it and what our hypothesis is on the sales on Amazon is divided into discoverability and viability. And we'll discuss about both of them. And then we'll talk about role of inorganic visibility in this. And then finally, the beast in the room, which is AMS. We'll also talk about a little bit of cool things that we've been doing around playing with Amazon and, that's it. One small, this thing announcement that there are different sets of audience on this call. So, I've tried to keep it as simple as possible, yet, explore depth of Amazon ecosystem in many topics. In case you have, other questions or, we'd be happy to discuss with you after the presentation. And, if you want to discuss more sophisticated strategies for Amazon, happy to do that as well. So basically, let me start with the concept of, digital marketing funnel. Now, this is a basic marketing funnel, which, a lot of people call it by different names. Some people call it as AIDA, awareness, intent, desire, action. Some people call it as awareness, consideration, conversion, retention. So it's basically, you start with making a consumer aware of, what your product is, what your brand is, and finally leading to sales. And this funnel, is typically same across, many centuries and decades, and everybody's been using it. There's a slight, nuance.
I'm asking you to, I'm sorry, interrupting you. Chetan says you're not audible. Are there others that are not able to hear Tarun? If you could just put it on the chat, because it's okay. Navjot can hear. Okay, it's all good. Chetan, could you just test the audio at your end again, please? Tarun, back to you.
Okay, awesome. So a little bit of nuance in digital marketing is that, it gives you a platform for talking directly to people who are looking for conversion. And that is where Amazon comes in. Earlier, if you look at the marketing funnels, when you have to launch a new brand in the offline world, first you have to create awareness, then you have to create consideration and then conversion. Here on Amazon, it is actually possible to, talk about the product directly to people who are looking to buy. So it's an audience which is there. So, our job there is to, convert, as they say, bottom of the funnel and talk to them directly. There are some strategies of retention also on Amazon, but that's a topic for another day. But today we'll focus on conversions. Now, again, coming back to the basics of marketing, there are any revenue works in two ways, right? It is about driving traffic and then the traffic that has come, talking to them and then converting the traffic. Now, some people call it as penetration and loyalty. Some people talk about as top of the funnel, bottom of the funnel. But you give it the name you want and whatever the concept that you are familiar with. But ideally, at the end of the day, it is about getting people to view your product and finally converting those users. So that's basically our job on Amazon. Driving traffic basically means discoverability, and converting that traffic basically means buyability. So this is something, you know, how, you know, fundamentals of conversion, which is bottom of the funnel. And that is how it works. You start with, you know, improving your discoverability. Now, when I say discoverability, it means your product being visible on Amazon. And we'll talk about it in a lot more detail in coming slides. Then once you improve discoverability, either through, you know, optimizing your listing or through inorganic traffic, you get more impressions. You drive more traffic to your page. Then you improve buyability, which is, you know, improving the probability of purchase. And then, you know, if you are selling more, then it gives you a better position on Amazon SERP. SERP stands for search engine result pages. And, you know, how Amazon's algorithm works is that if you have more sales velocity, you'll get more visibility. And this, you know, very soon becomes a virtuous platform, virtuous cycle where, you know, you can basically keep growing your impressions, keep growing your traffic, keep growing your sales, and hence visibility. And it can very easily be converted to a vicious cycle. If you're not able to get traffic, then sales drop, and then visibility drops, and then buyability drops, and so on. So, you know, it's a continuous cycle of improvement, you know, and that's how, you know, this thing works. Now, we have to, you know, if the whole game is about conversion, we'll talk about two aspects of it, discoverability and buyability. You know, first we'll talk about buyability because, you know, it lends itself to an independent evaluation. You know, this is also the first task that you know, any seller would do once they hook onto Amazon, because first you do your listings and then, you know, you promote those listings. So we start with buyability, we talk about buyability a little bit, and then we move to discoverability. You know, so, you know, what exactly is included when we talk about buyability? Obviously, it starts with content, you know, your images, your product description, your A+ content. Then it comes to pricing, which is, you know, what is your absolute pricing? For example, if you're selling a shampoo, which is 2000 rupees for a small bottle, it is going to be a tough sell because, you know, of the absolute pricing. However, if you're selling for 400 rupees and you're offering no discount, then, you know, that could also be a hindrance to sales. So that's about pricing. Then obviously reviews. You know, a lot of studies across the world say that 80% of decisions are made while looking at reviews. So how many reviews you've got, what is the average rating, and so on, you know, depends on the viability of the product. Then delivery timelines, where, you know, nobody wants to wait for a shampoo for 4 days. So if you are not able to offer an next day delivery across India, that has an impact on viability, and, you know, there are ways to tackle it, and so on. Then there are Amazon properties. I'm sure if you're you know, aware of the platform, you would have seen some you know, product listings would have tags like bestsellers tag or Amazon's choice or deal of the day, you know, these kind of tags, which, you know, helps build confidence and trust among the customers that, you know, if Amazon is recommending it, it must be good. So, you know, once this basically, you know, encompasses a lot of you know, detail on once the customer has landed on your page, what are the things that you can do to improve your performance on the buyability, which is basically conversion. Okay, now obviously, you know, there are a lot of things and a lot of different point of views on how the catalog images should look like, how A+ content should look like, and I feel that's you know, another session in itself. But, you know, there are certain basics on how you know, leading brands across the world do it. You know, contrasting colors, bold text, white background of the primary image. You know, talking clearly about benefits, not using many words, showing the benefit, showing happy people. You know, things like that, which are basic. You know, things in terms of catalog images and things you can do to improve your conversions. Similarly, you know, in A+ content, now there is a small nuance that I want to tell here, that A+ content is basically a conversion metric for Amazon. Amazon does not use A+ metric to drive SEO for their A9 algorithm, and we'll talk about that also. But it uses the A+ content for increasing conversions. If you see, a recent change in Amazon's app now, the A+ content comes before the product description. So basically, A+ content is becoming more and more important among Amazon's sellers. And it's a conversion tool. So, using a lot of images, not too many words, and they say, picture says 1,000 words. And, the attention span of average customers is very low. So using a lot of, contrasting images and giving the benefit in a very, very succinct way is very important. So, that's on content. Now we move our focus to a slightly more complicated topic of discoverability. This is how I look at discoverability. Imagine, if you have to buy real estate, what are the factors that you look for? Locality, size, type of property, price. And let's say your objective is to open a shop, right? And if you have to open a shop, you want to look at, okay, is it close to people who want to visit my shop? Can I get, access for parking? Can I get, people to see my board and so on? Consider Amazon as a big city, and you looking to buy a shop in that city. And that's the analogy, I think, which, explains discoverability in a good way, where, okay, you want to buy a shop and then you want to be where the people are. So your keyword discoverability is basically what people are looking for. And hence, if you're closer to what people are looking for, there are chances that, you will buy it. Now, you can go to a fancy higher rental area, which will be obviously more expensive, but it will give you a lot of visibility, and that is part of which are basically high competitive keywords where you're targeting, you're basically competing with lot. And then the other option is that you go to a slightly less crowded place, and then you pay obviously lower rent, you maybe make less money, but profitability might be higher. And these are called long tail keywords or branded keywords, where you make a lot more money, but you can't get a lot of customers. So I hope to be able to understand discoverability. Imagine a shop in the city and Amazon being that city. That's how that's the fundamental of discoverability. Why is discoverability important? I mean, it's the most important thing because 70% of sales on Amazon happens on the first page of SERP, and then discoverability is always dependent on the keyword which the customer is typing here. And and you can imagine that all the top listings, they say that 50% of sales happens on the first three listings, and Amazon wants to make money on all those listings. And then the organic listings, which are the top selling and relevant for that keyword, start here. So this discoverability is important because that's where the entire real estate is. You have to be here to beat the crowd, and obviously Amazon wants to make money out of it, and you can do things to improve your organic listing so that you don't have to pay Amazon so much, and you still can be visible on top of the page. Again, just trying to make it slightly simple that it's all about getting page views and getting impressions. So the job of discoverability is to, one, get impressions, two, get clicks. And after the clicks have come, then the job of viability starts, where it's about converting those customers. So there are three ways to get that real estate. One is organic impressions, where you do a lot of SEO of what people are searching for, and is your listing relevant for those keywords. Then there are some cool Amazon hacks that you can use in terms of hidden keywords, which is when you are listing a product, you can use hidden keywords to put more data into making your listing more relevant for the target audience. And obviously the third is target audience, which Amazon tracks and puts into its algorithm to make your listing more relevant. A lot of people are not using hidden keywords and target audiences, but we feel that it is a very, very powerful tool without disrupting your brand's content flow on the on the main page, because a lot of people try to optimize title using keywords, and then it looks really ugly, the title. It is optimized for the Amazon's algorithm, but maybe not as optimized for the customer's brand experience. So these are a few tools that we can use. Then the second is paid impressions, which I'm sure a lot of you are using in terms of AMS, which is on Amazon, buying impressions, and then off Amazon, which is web traffic. You can use social media, you can use Google, and so on to get impressions. The third really cool way to get impressions is Amazon properties, which is the deals page, launchpad, topical pages like Mother's Day, etc., etc. These are really cool because they're very frequently visited by Amazon's customers, and then you don't have to pay so much for AMS if you are on these pages, and it's a way around for you to get more impressions without spending a bank on paid impressions, right? So this is part of discoverability, and then once the discoverability comes, then the idea is to get a lot more clicks, which is partly a game of discoverability and partly a game of viability. And then finally, once the people the customer has landed, then you talk about conversion. So again, we always believe in tracking and quantifying things, and this is a really cool way of doing it. The keywords are split into three broad categories: generic keywords, branded keywords, and branded product keywords. Let's say, to give you an example, generic keyword would mean hair fall shampoo. A branded keyword would mean Indulekha, and a branded product keyword would mean Indulekha shampoo. So obviously, your discoverability, depending on whether it is a generic keyword or a branded keyword, would be very different, because a lot of competition would be there on generic keywords, but not so much on branded and branded product keywords. And even for relevance of Amazon's algorithm, if somebody is searching for Indulekha shampoo, it makes sense for Amazon to show Indulekha shampoo and not other shampoos, because it leads to customer dissatisfaction and lower conversions as well. So if you look at the table below, this is a really cool way of tracking. This is your product name. And then, as I said, that by discoverability is dependent on the keyword. So you decide, what keyword you want to track it for, and then whether this keyword is a generic or a branded keyword, and then what are the search volumes for that keyword. So obviously, you would want to focus on keywords which are high on search volume, and then what is your rank on that keyword. So on that keyword, if you are ranked on page 1, page 2, page 3, that would have a lot of impact on how much impressions you want to get and how much visibility you want to get for these so if on a keyword which has very high search volume, like 74,000, and you are on page 2, let's say you're 70 average, it makes a lot of sense to spend some money and get it to on a page 1, because it is a highly, highly searched keyword. So, we at Bundy's do this in an automated way, and we have built crawlers to do it, on Amazon, Amazon's ecosystem. But, it's also possible to do, at least for, a few important keywords, with someone doing it manually and checking, their rankings every few days at least. Okay, so this was on discoverability, and finally, the beast in the room is paid discoverability, let's talk about the basics of paid visibility, and in a way, how does Amazon make money? Amazon makes money when a customer clicks on a ad, right? Amazon doesn't make money if they show an ad. So it is important for them to show ads which have high quality score, because if they show ad which is low quality score, and I'll talk about the quality score, they don't make any money. Also, they make more money when somebody bids higher. So it's a combination of both that you have to maintain to get higher impressions. If you're a bit, let's say you really want this keyword, and you're willing to bid 500 rupees for that keyword, but your quality score is really low for that keyword, and then you're not getting any clicks, Amazon does not make any money, and obviously they'll deprioritize that bid, even though your bid is 100 times more than the next competitor, right? So quality score is split between two parts. One is the performance of that ad, and then the relevance. As I said, performance is click-throughs. If a lot of people are clicking on that ad, that's a performance quality for Amazon. And then relevance, even if people are clicking for it and then not converting because of low relevance, let's say you're able to get a lot of people to your page, but nobody's converting. That leads to dissatisfaction among Amazon's customers. So Amazon doesn't want you to have low quality ads, whether it is in terms of relevance or performance. Let's say somebody's selling hair brushes, and they also bid on hair, and a lot of hair shampoo searches are happening. So while they might be getting a lot of impressions and even clicks as well, but no conversion. So the relevance is not there, and then Amazon ultimately would deprioritize that ad. Net, I think. What we're talking about here is the bid value, which is a science in itself of how much to bid, and then second is the quality score which you need to maintain to leading to higher impressions. So bid and impression have a relationship, which is higher bids lead to higher impressions. However, it's not a direct correlation that higher you bid, the higher impressions you will get. There are a lot of other things to focus as well. Now, very quickly, I want to talk about the structure of AMS and how you should look at how to structure your campaigns and how to talk about those campaigns. So the hierarchy is campaign, ad group, keyword, and then bid. The products are defined at an ad group level. The campaigns is divided into three types of campaigns, which is sponsored product, which is an ad that shows in the Amazon search engine result page or on the product display page. Sponsored brand is a branded display which happens either on the top of the page of search engine or on the middle of the page. And display could happen on Amazon, off Amazon, and you can get clicks through that. Ad group, ideally, we recommend that each product should have its own ad group because your keywords are defined at ad group level. If you're putting a lot of products in a single ad group, then that means that you're bidding for the same keywords for different products, which to my mind doesn't make too much sense because, even if you are selling face washes, different face wash and different variants of face wash should target different keywords. So if you're selling 100 products, at the minimum, you should have at least 100 ad groups. That should also be split between, different types of campaigns. So 100 into three types of campaigns. So, maybe 300. And then, there are some keywords which deserve their own ad group. And I will talk about that as well. There are keyword types that Amazon defines in terms of search, which is exact, broad, and phrase. And depending on what cost of sales you're getting on these three, your bids should be decided differently. Maybe you bid higher for exact and you bid lower for phrase. Amazon also provides bid optimization, through dynamic bid up and down, dynamic bid down only, and static. We also recommend that we use dynamic bid down only because up and down could lead to a lower A cost, and static bid just makes you lose more money. That said, a lot of things need to be taken care of in terms of at a campaign level. There is bidding strategy, as I said, what kind of bid you want to put, and then what is a daily budget, and what negative keywords you want to define, and ad placement, which is a very cool concept by Amazon, where you can pay higher to be on the top of the page. So if 50% of sales happening in top three search results, so I might as well pay higher to be there, and have a lower A cost still. And, there's a lot of science behind it, and we can discuss it, offline, because this is a science in itself. So at an ad group level, you define keywords, you define negative keywords, and you decide bid values. At a keyword level, you define the bid type, the click-throughs and A cost is what you track. And then there is a direct correlation between bid and number of impressions. It is not linear, but there is a relationship between bid and impressions. As I said, each group should have its own ad group, and no two products will have the same exact keywords and exact same strategy. So we would recommend that you should not put any two products in the same ad group. They can also be further split up between type of keyword. You might want to have a ad group for just generic keywords for that product, and branded keywords has a separate ad group, and a branded product keyword has a separate ad group. That we should not do for all campaigns because then it will get very, very complicated to manage those campaigns. But 80-20 rule should be applied, where top selling products should have their own campaigns. Like theoretically speaking, each product could have up to 15 campaigns running, depending on what are the hero keywords and what kind of keywords are we targeting. Again, campaigns, some products will have all three campaigns, but some will not. And then high performing keywords deserve their own campaigns because for better placement. And then for bit time for manually managed campaigns, we recommend that it should be dynamic downward only bids. Now, just to figure out what should be your target ACoS, because that's a huge question of how much should you be spending. That depends on basically two types. What is the type of the product and where on the life cycle the product is, according to us. So if it is a discovery product, you might want to spend a lot higher to get more visibility once start that virtuous cycle. However, as you move to launch, then it should be reduced a bit. When you move to growth, it should move a lot lesser. And when you're looking for driving traffic, for driving profit, then it should be reduced a lot. That said, it also depends on gross margin. If you're selling a product which has 90% gross margin, then you might be interested in spending a lot on ACoS to get that discoverability. But if the product is making less than 10% margins, then you don't want to spend too much on marketing, because otherwise you'll run into losses. So that's how you should look at a target ACoS. And for us, we believe that in your Amazon strategy, each product should have its own defined target ACoS, and it should be monitored at least once a week, and definitely once a month, to figure out where you want to play and whether this product is viable to sell on Amazon or not. How to manage bids? There are basically two types of optimizations that you can do. One is rule-based optimization, where you create rules that, okay, if my ACoS goes up by 20%, then increase my bid or decrease my bid. If my click-through rate goes down by this much, then do this. And then similarly, the other is the adaptive dynamic bidding, which part of it Amazon also does. But there's a lot of mathematical models being involved, and we at Quantius are also developing one of our own. But there could be different goals for adaptive bidding, which is more dynamic and can keep changing theoretically every few hours. That, okay, you want to maximize revenue in a given budget. That, okay, I'm going to spend 5 lakhs on Amazon this week. What is the maximum revenue that we can get? Or the other is that I want to minimize ACoS. Okay, that my target ACoS is 20%. What is the maximum revenue that we can get for this? Or you could have product level goals, as I said, that this is a launch product or this is a growth product, and that's how I define my adaptive dynamic bidding. So that's how we do it at 1DS, that we have different optimization modules where it could be either maximizing profit or minimizing maximizing the revenue or target ACoS or minimizing ACoS. And then we run a lot of mathematical models which involves machine learning and so on to figure out what is the global minima for you in terms of ACoS, where you can theoretically in the model input things like time of the day of the week, type of the product, target ACoS, and so on, and figure out, okay, this, if these are the constraints and rules that you're working with, what is the maximum revenue that you can get on AMS. So that's how we do it at AMS. That's folks, at the end of my session. But there is one really cool thing that we are doing it at 1DS and crawling Amazon for a lot of things. And I just wanted to show you a couple of slides of work that we are doing with the client, and how a lot of people ask us that the NPD cycle, which is new products cycle on Amazon, is really low, and new products come very soon and take the market. And so we thought, okay, is there a data way to figure out how can we identify trends? And what we've done is we build these crawlers which crawl Amazon site, and then we apply some language processing to figure out what ingredients, what benefits are used, and what kind of subcategories are doing better in terms of sales and in terms of growth. So this is something where we identified, okay, if you talk about beauty, how things are in terms of what is the numeric share, whether Bath and Body is selling more, fragrance, hair care, etc., and what are the subcategories like shampoos, soaps, deodorants, and what are the brands that are selling, right? So we in an automated way are able to capture what kind of categories, subcategories are doing better, and what kind of products are growing better. So you can launch products in those categories. We can also do sort of ingredient benefit, like in terms of hair care, what kind of ingredients are doing better, and what kind of benefits. So the people are talking about hair fall, or strong hair, or shining hair, or nourish, or they're talking about aloe vera, keratin, etc. So these are, you know, really cool things that we are doing on Amazon's platform, and you know, we are deep into it, and we are looking forward to hearing your comments and partnering with you to help you grow sales on Amazon. I would open this for questions now, and you know, these are our contacts, and you know, if you want to contact later, you can connect with us on this. Thank you so much.